You mentioned Libya, you mentioned Syria, you mentioned the UN Security Council, you mentioned military forces. So to go really straight to the point, well, following the debacle in Libya in 2011, then Brazil came up with the responsibility while protecting. So saying, okay, we have to bring that a little bit further. There has to be a criteria that have to be discussed before using force. And also there has to be a review mechanism. So the question would be, did this initiative lead anywhere? Are there any lessons here?
If you're looking for a way to recreate consensus in the Security Council following the debacle over Libya and the very negative implications of that for Security Council decision making subsequently, I think the Brazilian proposal going back to 2011 of RWP responsibility while protecting is and remains the best way forward. And I think it's very important to keep that particular flame alive. Of course, if the dreadful Mr. Bolsonaro gets elected in Brazil, we're not going to be hearing much more from Brazil about anything remotely humanitarian or credible, but at least the idea was a very important one when it was articulated in 2011. What is the idea? The idea is essentially very, very simple. When stripped, there was a lot of debate about it, but when it's stripped down to its essentials, it is, as you say, has two components. One was that if a military mandate is to be granted by the Security Council, then it should only be after very careful and detailed and self-conscious attention is given to the criteria of legitimacy. And I'll come back to what that means in just a moment, for the use of military force. That in order to build a genuine consensus, in other words, not just a transient consensus or a response to passing pressures that people feel, but a genuine consensus, there should be attention paid to those understood criteria. Not criteria of legality, but criteria of legitimacy, and the maximum possible buy-in should be reached. That was the first part of the proposal, and seems to me to be eminently sensible. The second part of the Brazilian proposal was essentially there should be some kind of monitoring and review mechanism, not necessarily very formal, but one to which there was genuine buy-in by all members of the Security Council, such that when a military mandate was given in an R2P situation, or indeed any situation, but an R2P one, let's assume, there would be regular review of how that mandate was being applied by the Security Council. The countries that were conducting the use of force would have to come back to the Council and explain whether the mandate was sufficient for the particular purpose that had been identified, the civilian protection purpose, or whether it needed extension or variation, and would give other countries the opportunity to say that the mandate's being exceeded and overreached in order to be narrowed or concluded. We're used to sunset clauses, we're used to periodic reviews of mandates in the context of protection of civilians' mandates and peacekeeping operations. This is no big deal for the Security Council to accept. But it is offensive to some countries on the Security Council. I mean, the United States wants to preserve at all costs its divine right of ad hocery when it comes to dealing with these situations. And I'm afraid sometimes the US and the UK have not been very much better. And they're still reluctant to accept, even to this day, that they may have overreached in Libya in 2011 and caused the problems largely themselves that we're now confronting. But if that bites, that idea of careful attention to criteria and agreement on regular review, monitoring and reconsideration of the continued applicability of the mandate, if that could be agreed, then I think we could recreate consensus. Because, you know, going back to the point I was making about the normative force of R2P, for all the posturing and the great power thuggery and so on that goes on, the realpolitik, I don't think anybody really wants to go back to the bad old days when these atrocities were occurring on a massive scale and the international community was just pretending that it was absolutely nobody's business. I think there is a genuine, you know, moral obligation that is being felt, even by the most implausible of countries. And we ought to find ways of operationalizing that moral sentiment and taking away the excuses they now have for not doing anything.